Hey, Streetwalkers. I've been telling Steve for years, you need to put out the best episodes again so people can relive the thrill of the best ones, the ones that are really, really art. But that's almost all of them, isn't it, Streetwalkers? But this month, March 2024, you're going to get to hear my picks. Here we go.
I'm a fireball.
Next up on Shawn's picks are 70s multi-platinum recording artists. And we are going to hear some of my very favorite episodes in number 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And we're starting off with Thomas McClary. Let me tell you why I love this episode. This is actually my all-time number one favorite Fascination Street podcast episode for a few reasons. First of all, the music. The music is off the chain, and you're going to hear stories from the civil rights, from the lived experience of Thomas McClary, and how somebody could be so loving and forgiving after all the things that happened during those years is really beyond me. So Thomas McClary, who I met in person, a wonderful inspiration, an incredible musician, the founding member of the Commodores, you're going to love it. My very favorite episode, number 2 of Shawn's picks, Thomas McClary.
Fireball.
I know it sounds funny, but I'm super excited now. Because I'm talking to Thomas McClary. Welcome to Fascination Street Podcast, Thomas McClary. How you doing today, man?
Great, Steve. How are you today, buddy?
I am over the moon.
All right. Likewise, I've been anticipating talking to you and I'm very excited.
All right. Well, a little bit of backstory for those listening. Last Christmas, I was at a corporate event, a corporate Christmas party, and lo and behold, the musical guest was, get this, the Commodores.
Oh, right.
And I almost peed myself. I was so excited. And let me tell you folks this, the Commodores will still melt faces and get those booties on the dance floor. We had so much fun. I've never seen so many people dance for so long. It was a blast. And then after the show, I went up and I spoke with Mr. McClary and I gave him my card and I said I would love to interview him. And we took a picture together. And if that's okay with you, that's the picture I'm going to use when I post this.
Perfect.
And here we are. So, Thomas, again, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day to hang out and let me fan out a little bit. Now, I did hear somebody calls you T-Mac. Is that the truth?
I'm the original T-Mac.
Nice. Now, is it only close friends or can fools like myself call you T-Mac?
Oh, absolutely, Steve. You're most definitely.
I appreciate that. All right, T-Mac. So let's start off, man. Where were you born and raised? Where are you from?
Well, I'm from Florida. It's Eustis, Florida. It's about 30 miles north of Orlando. In fact, I still have close ties to that small town. Played golf yesterday, in fact, with the pastor of the church there and Philip Scott, who is also my brother-in-law and my brother. So we still are well connected there.
Nice. So long before you went to Tuskegee University, you were among the very first African Americans to integrate into your local public school. Is that right? When you were growing up?
That's right. In fact, I was the first African American student to integrate the schools down here in the state of Florida. It was a very challenging time. You know, it was the civil rights movement was very formidable at that time, and it was 1965. We had a very racist sheriff who had acquired national attention as he had arrested. And, of course, a lot of blacks had died mysteriously while being under arrest under his leadership. So my parents, who was very supportive, obviously, we were threatened by the Ku Klux Klan and had bricks and oranges thrown at me. as I came onto campus, and of course, a lot of racist slurs, but we were determined, and of course, the challenge was met with nonviolence.
Now, what grade was this? Was this elementary school, middle school, high school?
Yes, this was high school. This is my 10th grade year.
All right. Well, pardon me for asking, but what made you continue? Why didn't you just say, this isn't worth it? What made you keep going?
Well, I was an avid fan, obviously, of Dr. King and his movement. And the school was much closer to my home than the school that I was being bused to. And I was curious. I'd heard about the books and everything that we had substandard books. And I knew that at some point it would be, whether my generation or not, that the things that was happening nationally, that eventually, and even in a small town like Eustis, that some action needed to be taken. And so with the support of my parents and my family, that's all I needed. Because now, mind you, Steve, it was very tough, but I was getting it from both sides. My black friends and some of the teachers at the black schools, they were kind of puzzled, too. They was like, man, why are you doing this? Because, you know, you've been on the honor roll every 6 weeks, and you have been voted president of your class, you know, and you played sports, you know, baseball and football. So I wasn't doing it for the attention from a popularity standpoint, but it was merely the injustice of not having access to public libraries, and you couldn't even go to the movie theaters, the public swimming pools. It was a lot at stake there in terms of breaking some of those barriers.
Gotcha. Well, I'm sorry about your experience. That must have been rough. You said that you had heard that the books and things were better at the white school. When you got there, was it true? Was everything noticeably different or better at the white school?
Oh, no question about it. Our books at the black schools were handed down, you know, previous owners that had markings, and some of the pages, you know, might have been missing or torn or whatever, you know. And it's funny. It was a motivating factor for me as well, because, for instance, just one quick story, the English instructor, one of the exams included memorizing a poem as a part of your score. You know, she says, well, just memorize a little poem or something to recite. And so the other students did exactly that. And instead, I memorized The Raven.
The whole thing?
The whole thing, right.
Oh, Lord.
In fact, Steve, had I not had the journey that I had, I don't think I would have been prepared to deal in the music business, because the music business was extremely tough. I mean, it still is, but it hardened me, you know, in ways, and toughened me up in ways that I needed it. Another little quick story. 25 years after I graduated, obviously, the Commodores, you know, we were famous and all. And I went back to the class reunion, and it was amazing. Some of the students, you know, they had brought their kids to the reunion because they heard I was going to be there, and they invited their parents and everything. And so they wanted me to just for 5 minutes talk about what it was really like for me at that time. And I thanked all of the people that threw the rocks at me, and I thanked the coaches that wouldn't let me play the position, the quarterback, and all the guys that burnt my sweater literally while my sweater was on, because I thought that that was a part of the journey that made me tough. And of course, I had forgotten about the guy that tried to kill me that was on the baseball team, who, and it was just the grace of God that I had my back turned, and I bent down to pick up my glove the instant he closed his eyes and swung the bat. And so he was standing in the line waiting to get my autograph, and I kept watching him, and he was in tears. And, you know, so when he finally got his turn, he asked me to forgive him for trying to kill me. And I told him, I said, you know, Richard, I really had forgotten all about that incident. In fact, I had forgiven you already, and forgotten about it, even to the extent of not even mentioning it in my book, because I would have mentioned that for sure in the book.
Wow. Holy moly. Well, I don't even know what to say, man. I guess, you know, you hear a lot that if you're going to get into the music business or into the movie business or TV business or whatever, that you're going to need a thick skin, because there's a lot of, let's just say, a lot of stuff coming your way that maybe isn't the sweetest or nicest. And so I guess you're right in that.
Yep.
I guess it was okay because you got a thick skin, but it still sounds like a terrible way to get a thick skin, man.
Yeah.
Sorry about all that.
Yeah, it was. There were moments, man, when you think, well, is there a window to turn around? And then, of course, as I watched the national news and then, of course, Emmett Till and all the different things that was going on, you know, it was like, no, you can't do that. You can't turn around. And only to get into Tuskegee my freshman year, 2 days after I'm there, student bodies organizing a march on downtown Tuskegee because the year prior to me coming, Sammy Young Jr. had gotten killed for going into a all-white restroom downtown. So I left Eustace breaking the ice of injustice and racism only to come to an all-black college to have George Wallace come and send the troops in to try to break up a peaceful protest. And in fact, the radio station downtown Tuskegee, the owner there was excited and afraid. He thought that the students was going to come and burn down his station. And so a student by the name of Tom Joyner, who was a sophomore at that time, he asked the owner of the station if he could use the platform to just inform the community as to why we were protesting. And that was Tom Joyner's first time going on radio, as a matter of fact.
Tom Joyner, ladies and gentlemen, went on to be huge. He's still huge now. I have a friend, actually, who is, I believe he is the official photographer for the Tom Joyner cruise every year.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. My buddy's name is Daryl Edwards. And he runs J&K Photography here in San Antonio. Super good, yeah. Dude.
Yes, yes.
Before we move away from this, I hadn't planned on talking about this much, but I just have one more question about that turbulent time. Well, I guess two more questions about that turbulent time in American history and in your life.
Oh, sure.
How
sure.
come those events and your experiences didn't make you angry or militant? How come?
Well, I was born in a Christian home, and I knew that love and unforgiveness, you know, if you harbor unforgiveness and bitterness, it could be even more detrimental to you versus showing love and forgiveness. So that was the thing that got me through.
Great answer. I love it. And I think that mindset has probably saved a lot more lives than we will ever know.
Yep, yep.
Last question about that topic. How do you feel that the civil rights movement back then compares to what's going on in America right now?
I love what's happening now as far as the energy of the youth and the multiracial. It was multiracial back then too, you know, of course, but I think you have more whites now participating than back then. But the one thing that I would love to say to the Shakers and the Movers today is the tenacity of the leaders back then, Dr. King in particular, and his movement, and the patience. I mean, because it wasn't overnight that they eventually saw some results, but it was over periods of time. And of course, I see that there's a momentum here, and my prayer is that it doesn't stop. You know, and when you look at the injustice, it goes so far back. Obviously, you can't expect overnight success to get rid of all of the systemic things that are happening, but I would just encourage them to not give up.
Gotcha. Thank you for that.
Yes,
now
sir.
Let's move on to some way happier subjects.
Hey, Streetwalkers, here's a word from our sponsors.
Hey, Streetwalkers. On February 26th, we will release our 400th episode. I want to give each and every one of you a huge thank you for riding with me all the way to this giant mile marker. For the first time since the show started, I'm going to be taking a little break for the month of March. There will be no new episodes, but instead, I'll release an older episode every weekday of the month in a best of style, showcasing some of my wife's favorite conversations. Enjoy these 21 Fascination Street classics Monday through Friday, every weekday in the month of March, and I'll be back with all new episodes beginning April 1st. I couldn't do this without you, so tell a friend, and thanks again for being Streetwalkers.
Let's get back into it.
So, tell me about that fateful day at Tuskegee University in the line to sign up for classes.
Yeah, man. I had formed a band in high school. And so I got my feet wet, you know, as far as entertaining. And as a freshman, I didn't know anyone. And I thought a good way to meet girls and meet people would be to maybe start a band and kick it off with the freshman talent show.
Good plan.
Yeah. So I'm standing in the registration line. And maybe 10 or 12 people back in the line, I hear this guy whistling a song by Eddie Harris. And the song was called Listen Here. It was an instrumental. And Eddie Harris, for the listeners that are not familiar with him, he was a jazz artist, saxophonist. And he had started an innovative thing with his saxophone where he had electrified it, and it was a really great sound. Anyway, this guy was whistling all the nuances of the solo of the song. I'm like, oh, man, Tua, he has to be a musician. Let me go back here and introduce myself. So I go and I said, hey, man, are you a musician? And he was very shy, you know. He's like, not really. I said, well, I'm trying to find some musicians to put a band together for the talent show. And he says, well, I live here in Tuskegee, and I know some musicians, you know, and I live with my grandmother across the street from the campus. If you want me to, I'll round up some musicians for you. And you can use my grandma's basement to audition the guys. I said, oh, wow, what a nice gesture. This guy was Lionel Richie.
I've never heard that name before. I'm sorry. I'm unfamiliar with this person. Please continue.
So I get to his grandma's, and sure enough, he has, you know, Andre Callahan and two of the guys there, you know. And he walks down the stairway playing a sax. I said, oh, my God, I thought you said you were in a music. I play a little bit. Okay, man, you're in the band.
I feel like he just wanted to save that to make a really powerful entrance. I mean, just walking down the stairs playing the saxophone, that's amazing.
right. But now we have to decide on a name, and nobody would vote on the other guy's suggestion. So I said, okay, we'll just blindfold and just open up a dictionary and point to a word, and whatever that word is, that's going to be the name of the band. Well, we pointed to commode.
Are you serious?
Right. Nope, give me another chance.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And, of course, the second time we pointed to Commodores. And now we got a name, and, of course, it didn't happen, though, until after the talent show. So we used the Mystics as our initial name. Oh, man, I still remember the songs. We learned Cold Sweat by James Brown, and then Tobacco Road by Lou Rawls. And, of course, when the curtains opened, the guys were so stage frightened that all of them went behind the curtains except me and the drummer. And after they learned that we had won, you know, I had to introduce the band, and so that's when they came out from behind the curtains.
Very cool. I'm glad you told that story about the Commodores, because I was going to ask you where that name came from. So thanks for covering that. Now, I feel like y'all had some success pretty early. I know that you guys toured and opened for the Jackson 5 and a whole host of other folks. Tell me how you met and what was your relationship with Berry Gordy?
Well, I'm meeting a manager in New York, Benny Ashburn, who knew Suzanne DePass as a kid growing up. Suzanne DePass had gotten a job in New York at one of the discos down there on Broadway, and it was called The Cheetah. She had turned it around into a very successful spot, and Berry Gordy was moving Motown from Detroit to Los Angeles. So he was looking for some different types of personalities that he could bring to Los Angeles, and Suzanne happened to be one of the persons that he had chosen to run the new, what they call the artist relations, A&R department at that time. And Suzanne's first assignment was the Jackson Five. So when the Jackson Five had completed their initial coming out with Ed Sullivan and their hit and all, but they hadn't toured yet, she thought about her good friend, Benny Ashburn, who had this band of college kids that would be a good image with the kids. And she invited us to audition. And of course, they were very impressed. And so as a result of touring with the Jackson 5 for 2 years, Berry Gordy says, man, these guys are not signed. And we've given them all this exposure. It's just only natural to sign them as an artist. So that's how we met Mr. Gordy. And of course, that's how we got signed to Motown initially.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, at that time, Motown had had a bunch of gold records, but they were all singles. And the Commodores had the very first gold album in the history of Motown.
That's right.
So what did that do for you?
That gave us a lot of leverage, obviously, in our negotiations as far as our contracts, because it was a one album deal with the one option for them to pick that option up. And we decided that we wanted to go somewhere else if we couldn't get publishing rights. And of course, we were the first act in the history of Motown to do that. And as a result of us getting our publishing rights, Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Smokey Robinson followed in our footsteps afterwards.
So at the time, and you even said no artist had done that with Motown, at the time, that was not done really by almost any artist in any genre. So what gave you guys the forethought to ask or demand the rights to the masters?
Well, we had read a lot of horror stories, and we'd seen in the news, you know, a lot of stories. And of course, I have to give credit to, like I said, some of the earlier things in my life as well as, you know, with the civil rights and all. But just being a trailblazer, we knew that there are times when your Jackie Robinsons of the world or your Muhammad Ali's of the world, and later on your Tiger Woods and Michael Jordan's of the world, you know, you just feel like, man, if I don't do this and if I don't continue with the trajectory that I'm on, that I'm going to let myself down. And you can't live with yourself knowing better, you know, and knowing it would be different if you weren't aware. But once you are aware and you have an opportunity and the stars are all lined up for you to do certain things, you just have to know and trust that if you don't, you would never live with yourself. And then you weigh the two and you say, well, if I had to sit here and say, man, I should have, could have, or do I want to say, you know what, even if it doesn't work, I gave it all and I left it all out there on the floor.
That makes 100% sense. Well done. Oh, real quick, I just wanted to tell you that your song, Gimme My Mule, is the funkiest song I've ever heard. I think, in my opinion, that song is funkier than anything Parliament ever did. Folks, I don't know if you've heard this song, guys and girls, because this is sort of a deep track, but that is 5 minutes of Get Down. So, T-Mac, tell me, how much fun is that song to play, man?
Well, man, it is a lot of fun. What is so amazing that you would say that? Because as musicians, there is a satisfaction that we get as well. And I know the audience, you're the recipients and all, and you feel the energy and you move from the energy. But sometimes as a musician, when you're playing certain songs or when you're playing certain notes, certain grooves, man, it's like an amazing energy that just percolates inwardly. And I guess that's why you can sort of transfer it in a way, because it's coming from the heart, you know, and it's coming from the soul, you know. And so I guess that's why music has transcended all languages and stuff too, because when you're able to penetrate the hearts and the souls of people, then, you know, the races and the cultures, there are no barriers now, because now it's a direct line of communication from the heart to the souls of others.
I 1,000% agree. I don't even know the name of the album that's on. Can you tell me?
Moving on.
All right. Well, can we inject a little funk into this? Can I play that song?
Yes, sir.
Oh, fantastic. And will you do me a huge favor? Will you introduce it like you're a radio DJ?
Okay. Are you ready to really get down out there? Here it is. From the Commodores, funk like you've never heard it before. Give me my mule.
Give me my mellow place. Right here. Give me.
Nice. Thank you so much, man. I'm super excited to share that. I mean, I've never heard that song on the radio, and I don't think I've ever heard that song even mentioned anywhere. So I'm very excited to share that with my audience. So thank you.
Great, great.
Now, what does it mean to Commodoreize a song?
Well, it means to take the song as it exists and stretch it and take it into a place of comfort, using the gifts of the band and disregarding the rules as it relates to what normally musicians might do as far as standard chord changes or even breaking the rules as it relates to how many beats in a measure. For instance, in Easy, if you notice when the guitar solo comes in, some musicians may have four beats to a measure. We may put five beats in a measure, you know, just to throw it off a little bit. And when we didn't have hit songs, we played other artists' songs, like Wichita Lineman by Glenn Campbell. But if you heard our version of Wichita Lineman and Glenn Campbell's version, you automatically would know that it's been Commodoreized. Yes, the melody is there, the lyrics are there, but musically, you know, it's energy and it's a whole nother treatment. And so we kind of developed that name as related to us taking our own direction and saying, okay, we know traditionally it may or it might should go like this or whatever. No, we're going to just do it our way.
The special sauce.
That's it.
Nice. Now, I heard in an interview where the host said, seven-time Grammy-winning Commodores, but the Commodores Wikipedia page says 9 nominations and 1 win. What's the real number of nominations and wins?
That's the real nominations.
9-1?
9-1.
Gotcha. All right.
You know, for the audience, I think they need to understand, I'll give them a little background as to how these awards come about, particularly the Grammys. The Grammys is voted by the industry, and the record companies are obviously other industries. And it's almost like the Electoral College. You can win the popular votes, but if you don't have the electoral votes, you're not going to win the office. What happens is the small record labels are at a disadvantage, which Motown is a small record label compared to Columbia and Warner Brothers and all the big labels back then. So it becomes like block voting. So if I have a friend at Columbia and, you know, my buddy at Warner Brothers, and we want our artists to win the Grammy, we'll get together and say, okay, we'll cast all of our 12 votes on your artist, and you cast your 10 with our artist, and we'll block out the little guys, and we'll win most of the Grammys.
Gotcha. Thank you for that.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors. Let's get back into it.
Now, I think at one point you guys went to the Philippines and broke some attendance records. Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
I would imagine you guys broke attendance records almost everywhere you went.
It was amazing, man. 1975. We went to the Philippines, obviously, because Machine Gun had gone that whole album gold and created a new dance called the Bump. Ferdinand Marcos was the president at that time. And the Beatles' attendance record at Arenado Coliseum, they had 270,000. We had 272,000.
Whoa, you guys beat the Beatles?
Oh, yeah, we beat the Beatles.
Well, that's awesome.
And, of course, you know, Ferdinand sent the military to escort us from the hotel to the arena because there was hundreds of thousands of people in the streets with banners, "We love you, Commodores." So when we were coming back from a concert, this gentleman yelled from the balcony of the hotel that we were staying, and he says, "Hey, hey, who are you guys? I'm the greatest. Who's y'all?" It was Muhammad Ali.
Oh, my goodness.
Because we weren't that big in the States at that time, but he was there, you know, preparing for Thriller in Manila with
George Foreman.
George Foreman, right.
Wow. So did y'all hang out?
Oh, yeah. We took pictures and everything.
Oh, my goodness. That's awesome. Very cool.
Yeah.
I heard that you play every day. Is that still true?
Ooh, yes, sir. Every day, multiple times a day.
I also heard that you play the ukulele.
Yes, sir.
Really?
In fact, I think having played the ukulele initially, it was the grassroots for developing the style that I play on guitar, I think. Some of the untraditional methods and untraditional licks comes from the crossing of the style of the ukulele and the banjo. So it's interesting.
I'll say. That's awesome. I remember I mentioned your Wikipedia page for the Commodores earlier. Well, that same Wikipedia page for the Commodores lists you as having left the band in 1984. Is that accurate?
That is correct. Mm-hmm.
Wait a minute. Didn't the Commodores win a Grammy in 1986?
Yes.
Does that mean that you didn't win Grammy?
That's exactly right.
Oh.
Lionel and I had left the band at that time. But, you know, the American Music Awards and a lot of different other awards. But you're right. No. Night Shift was the Grammy song that won the Commodores their Grammy in 1986.
Now, when you say that you and Lionel left, did y'all leave together? Like, when he went solo, so to speak, were you part of that?
Well, you know, Lionel and I wrote most of the songs.
Most of the Commodore songs.
Most of the Commodore songs. Exactly. Okay. Right, right. And when the Endless Love Project came along, Lionel invited me to join him on that project with Donna Ross, the soundtrack. And then when the Kenny Rogers project came along, Lionel and I participated in that as well, in the writings of the songs for Kenny Rogers. And then, of course, his solo album. And I guess just a natural part of the growth, I left the band 2 months after he did.
Gotcha. Well, at some point, you returned to the Commodores. If you can you tell me why you and whatever that other guy's name is, Lionel or something, whenever, why did y'all leave?
Well, sometimes, you know, there's a natural growth that happens too, and I can't speak for the other guys, but I still have a great relationship with James Carmichael, for instance, who was a co-producer and all. His job was tough. He had to pick the songs, and obviously we were with Lionel and I writing most of the songs, and people wanted to grow and have space to grow, I guess. But my whole thing is you can't babysit for so long. Everybody has to grow up and everybody has to have space to do that. So I thought it might have been a good idea to give them the space so that they could grow and do whatever they felt they needed to do to expand, you know, as writers and performances, as whatever they wanted to pursue, you know.
Sure. Well, at some point, you got back in the Commodores. Can you tell me how that happened?
Oh, no. I didn't get back in.
No. Oh, okay. Well, tell me what's up.
Right. When you saw me, I was performing as Thomas McClary, Commodores Experience.
That's true.
So, oh, man. Oh, Steve, I got to send you. That's what I got to do. Boy, I just thought about it. I'm going to send you the new single that's coming out.
Okay.
And it's called Yes, I Still Have Joy.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. It's very powerful, and it's very timely for what's happening now. I've heard people say it kind of reminds them of the We Are the World type feel. It's a very exciting times because I am joining now my kids to part of this, and I have some other kids that I adopted as my kids. And I have some biological kids with me, obviously, in the group, but some of their friends. So it's young, it's vibrant, but it still has that creator of that sound. James Carmichael, my guy who co-produced it with us, you know, he's like, man, that signature sound, T-Mac, is still there. I'll make sure you get it, Steve, and hopefully you can share it with your audience.
Absolutely. You said it's called Yes, I Still Have Joy?
That's it.
Now, this is touchy, and it's okay if you don't want to talk about it, but in 2016, there was some litigation between some of the Commodores.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that at the conclusion of that litigation, it was established that you are the founder of the Commodores. Is that right?
That is correct.
Now, I know that you guys have known each other for, I'm going to say, 50 years.
Yep.
And for a period of time, you guys were more than friends. Y'all were brothers.
Mm-hmm.
I know that you said you're still on good terms with some of them. I'm assuming Lionel's one of them, and so is Walter. But are you on good terms with all of the Commodores?
As far as I'm concerned, I am. But are they on good terms with me? Probably not.
Gotcha.
You know, I'm from that school, love trumps everything. And I still love all those guys. However, you can't make somebody love you back. You know what I mean?
Well, you can, but then you go to prison.
You're right.
for kidnapping and things.
That's right.
Now, there's a lyric or so in Easy Like Sunday Morning.
Mm-hmm.
In that song, I believe you guys say, why would someone try to put chains on me? Something to that effect.
Mm-hmm.
And then something about how people want you to be what they want you to be.
Mm-hmm.
Are those lyrics, is like specifically with the chains and things, is that, are you talking about slavery? Are you talking about the music industry? Like, what is that song about?
Right. It's really about the industry. In this industry, you have managers, you have lawyers, you have agents, you have record companies, you have PR firms, and you have program directors. And then, of course, if you're in a band, you have the group members, and then you have your personal life, you know. And as you grow in all areas, you're going to be pulled on from different entities at different times and sometimes at the same time, you know. And then demands gets to be intense. At some point, though, you have to say, you know what, what's best for me? Well, you know. So that's basically the connotation.
All right. Well, I believe it's during that song. There is something referred to as the guitar solo.
Yes, sir.
Tell me a story about the guitar solo and how it basically changed your life.
Yeah, it certainly did. Well, I've always been a fan of, you know, Jimi Hendrix, like most other guitar, all other guitar players around the world, and Albert King, B.B. King, these guys. And looking at what was going on at that time, you know, you had the Eagles and different groups that were making statements, Fleetwood Mac. And I thought to myself, you know, when you look at the tones of these guitar players, it was the richness of those tones and the bite in which those tones grabbed the audience. So the first thing was you know, man, this could be a great opportunity to break out of the traditional R&B sounds and to introduce a crossover tone that would just be a statement to say, yeah, we can stand up with the big boys. You know, co-producer James Carmack, he'll be the first to tell you. He said, nah, Brother Thomas, man, that's a little different. Because it's a ballad, but God bless Carol Harris, who was our engineer. I must have spent like almost all day just working with him just to get the right tones that I wanted. But I'll never forget, after hours and hours of working on that tone, and then the solo itself just kind of flowed. And when the guys came back in after they had taken a break and they heard it, it was like, oh my goodness. Everybody knew it was something different, you know. And of course, Rolling Stone magazine for musicians, that's like the Bible. You know, you always dream of having an article written about you in that magazine. So that was my first Rolling Stone magazine write-up. It just kind of changed the trajectory of my career in a way that people like Carlos Santana and Eric Clapton and these guys, when you start getting compliments from them, you know, not that the fans don't matter, but your peers, obviously, you know, when you get compliments from your peers, it endorses the fact that maybe you have arrived to a place where you hadn't been before.
That makes sense. Now, the writer in Rolling Stone, his name was Dave Thompson, and he said, quote, one of the best guitar solo performances of all time.
Mm.
And I 1,000% agree. And I know that I have been super greedy, and I'm already going to play two songs, but can I just play the guitar solo?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Oh, you are awesome. It's so iconic. My wife and I were listening to that song, oh, I don't know, 2 weeks ago or something. And when that came on, my wife, she never sings along. She never hums. She never does any of that just because that's just not her nature. But when it got to the part of your guitar solo, she did the solo like with her mouth.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was like she sang what your guitar was doing. It was the most amazing. It stopped me in my tracks, and I just looked at her. And then when she was done, she looked up at me and she goes, what? Like, I don't even know if she knew she did that.
That's funny that you would say that, because obviously traveling around the world, local bands, you know, they play a song. It's amazing. Everybody that I've met from local bands around the world, the guitarists will come up to me and say, man, I got to tell you something. If you don't play that solo lick for lick like you did it, the audience will look at you funny.
Yeah, I bet. It's so iconic. I mean, I would venture to say that more people know that solo than they do the words to that song.
Yeah, it is amazing. It is amazing. I'm just speechless. I'm honored every time somebody recognizes that. But my kids are funny. You know, they're like, some days they'll come in, they'll peep in the studio, and they said, man, you were in there jamming like it's 100,000 people out there, and it's just you. It's gratifying, and it's an escape. I mean, I like golfing too, but this kind of takes me to my own little space, I guess.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That's your happy place, man.
That's right, man.
Takes you to your happy place. Now, yep. A couple of years ago, you wrote a book called Rockin' Soul.
Yep.
What is the book about? What could somebody find in there?
I found by just reaching into myself, and because a lot of times, and you know, Steve, for yourself, you don't go around talking about yourself daily or whatever. And in the midst of doing your daily chores or pursuing your career or doing whatever, a book gives you, in my instance, a chance to kind of reflect a little bit. And I wanted to share with the world some of the inside stories on the inspiration behind, you know, some of the songs and the inspiration of what it was like growing up, which we talked a little bit about, and just diving into some of the nitty-gritties of the challenges, not only in life, but the challenges in the industry. And through it all, though, having fun and how to get to that place despite the obstacles that may be confronting you.
Is that what you hope the reader gets out of that? Is that through all the obstacles, it's sort of a kind of a map on how to get to your happy place?
There you go.
Nice. At one point, there was some talk about making a movie and or a Broadway musical out of that book. Are those still in works?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Awesome. Very cool. T-Mac, Mr. McClary, can you tell everybody where they can find you on social media and also tell your website?
Yes, sir. The website is thomasmcclary.com. Instagram, Thomas McClary. Of course, Facebook, Thomas McClary.
Are you on Twitter?
Yes, Thomas McClary.
Oh.
As well.
So it should be easy to find, everybody. And
yep.
While we're talking about that, folks, go to FascinationStreetPod.com and click on the Amazon link. It'll take you to Amazon, and then you can buy Rockin' Soul by Thomas McClary. I'll get a penny. He'll get a dollar. Everybody will be happy. I think you can also buy that book at ThomasMcClary.com. I don't know. Do you have autographed copies as well on that site?
Yes.
Oh, cool. Well, everybody go there, actually. Go there and get an autographed one. I don't need a penny. Now, T-Mac, as we're heading out here, is there anything that we didn't talk about or I didn't ask you about that you wanted to talk about today?
Well, you have done an extraordinary, great job, and it's been a pleasure seeing just spending this time with you, man. I was impressed with the research you've done, because I had forgotten the writer of the Rolling Stone article, for instance. I mean, bam, there you were, bam, you were on it. It's always a pleasure. In fact, now I gotta tell the audience a little secret about you two, because see, my son Brandon had given me a little insight, and see, your reputation precedes you too, Steve, so it's not coincidental that the podcast is really hot and very sought after. So much continued success to you.
Well, thank you so much, and I'm blushing. Everybody, after Thomas and I hang up, we're going to go right into his new song, Yes, I Still Have Joy. So hold on for that. Don't miss that. Thomas McClary, I just want to thank you again so much for taking the time out of your busy day and your hectic schedule to hang out and let us get to know you a little bit better on Fascination Street, man. I really, really appreciate it.
All right, man. Well, thank you for the opportunity and much continued success.
To you as well. And the next time you're back in San Antonio, holler at a fella and we'll have a coffee together.
You got it, bro.
Thank you so much, man. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thank you so much, Steve. I appreciate you, man.
And I wasn't kidding. When we were at that Christmas party, people mm-hmm. were getting down. We had so much fun that night. It was amazing.
Yeah. Boy, I wish that even if you didn't do it for a career, that everyone could have the chance to see that audience from our perspective and appreciate the energy that we get, too, from the audience.
It has to fill you with joy. It just has to.
Oh, gosh, man. I'm telling you, Steve, it really is very, very satisfying.
My dad has been a bass player and a singer for the last 40 years in hard rock bands.
Mm.
And so I did a little bit of, you know, like I used to run the lights and I used to help roadie and all stuff like that. But
mm-hmm.
I know the joy that he felt, and I don't think he ever played for an audience of more than about 800 people. So I know how excited and happy he was to, you know, receive all of that joy and those good vibes from that crowd.
Oh,
so
yeah.
I can't even imagine what it feels like to have 100,000 people sending those vibes at you. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's really unique, you know.
Take up any more of your precious time. Again, I can't even believe I got to talk to you. Thank you so much. You are an American icon and a music legend. And thank you again. I really appreciate your time.
Well, hey, man, let's stay in touch, okay?
Absolutely, absolutely. You take
All
it
right,
easy, man.
See you.
All right.
Take care, buddy. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I appreciate you, man. You have a great rest of your day. And everybody, this is Yes, I Still Have Joy. opening music is the song FSP Theme, written, performed, and provided by Ambush Venn. Closing music is from the song Say My Name off the 2021 album Underdog Anthems, used with permission from Jax Hollow. If you like the show, tell a friend, subscribe, and rate and review the show on iTunes and wherever else you download podcasts. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. All the episodes are available there as well. Check me out on Vero at Fascination Street Pod and TikTok at Fascination Street Pod. And again, thanks for listening.